Mayday! Mayday! I mean this! I'm serious! For the whole world, mayday! 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 The United States has been seized by the New World Order! Mayday! 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 Everybody, you've been mesmerized and conditioned incrementally to accept it. Wake up to what's happened. Mayday, 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 mayday. Foreign countries have grabbed 8,000 miles of Texas roads and are now putting in the toll roads. The former chief economist of the World Bank Nobel Prize winner says it's part of going in the global receivership. Mayday, 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 mayday.
Your views directly.
There are too many of us on this earth, and we are taking too much of the earth and too many habitats, and there are more people on this earth than earth can support.
There's roughly, what, 6.7 billion of us. If that's too many, how many should there be?
What matters far more is that people focus, for the first time in recent history, focus on the serious business of concerted interventions all around the world to help manage countries in their family planning programs and to drive down average fertility. It is to get really serious about family planning interventions to drive down average fertility.
And then after that, we've got to stabilize the population. When I was born, there
were what's wrong with the population? I mean,
with too many people. That's why we have global warming. We have global warming because too many people are using too much stuff.
But
if there were less people, they'd be using less stuff.
So if it takes 10,000 generations to reach 2 billion, and then in one human lifetime, ours, it goes from 2 billion to 9 billion. Something profoundly different's going on right now. We're putting more pressure on the earth. Most of it's in the poorer nations.
There is a limit to the earth's carrying capacity, and we know we're entering very uncertain times. In the last 200 plus years since Malthus, the world has stopped being stable. It's now entering a period of immense instability.
The negative impact of population growth on all of our planetary ecosystems is becoming appallingly evident. The United Nations can and should play an essential role in helping the world find a satisfactory way of stabilizing world population.
The myth of overpopulation originated in England in 1798, when a vicar named Thomas Malthus, who fancied himself something of a mathematician, saw that food production increased incrementally, but people reproduced exponentially. He sat down and did some simple math, and summarily decided that the world would be out of food by 1890. He blamed reduced mortality rates, and recommended killing off the have-nots of society, lest the haves starve to death. This cry was taken up by Paul Ehrlich of Stanford University in 1968, who claimed that reckless human reproduction had overwhelmed the Earth. Massive famines would result, which would destroy, best-case scenario, one-fifth of humanity by the end of the 70s, and the planet would follow. This fear produced large donations for the newly created UNFPA, which thrives on an imagined crisis that has been both imminent and rescheduled again and again over the past two centuries. The truth of the matter is that every family on this planet could have a house, with a yard, and all live together on a landmass the size of Texas, which is really just a small corner of the planet. The population of Earth will peak in 30 years, and then start to go back down. We're not overpopulated. Do the math. At some point in the year 2011, the Earth will hold 7 billion people on its surface, more people than any point in recorded history. While some welcome this latest member of humanity with excitement, others with fear. When people hear that we've been adding 1 billion people every 15 years, they imagine humanity's growth to look something like this. But 1 billion people isn't as high a percentage of humanity as it used to be. For instance, imagine this roller coaster car represents 1 billion people. If we add another car, or 1 billion more people, our train has doubled in length. But if we want to double the train again, we can't just add one more train car. We'd have to add two. Every time we make the train longer, one train car represents a smaller and smaller percentage of the train. If it takes 15 years to add each new train car, then mathematically speaking, the growth rate is slowing. In order for the growth rate to stay constant, the train would have to keep doubling every 15 years, instead of just adding one car. Human population growth is the same way. In 1804, the world's population hit 1 billion. By 1927, that number had doubled. But by 1960, that number had only grown by half. By 1975, it was only growing by a third, and then a fourth, and then a fifth. To see how population growth is slowing down, we look at a number called the global total fertility rate, which is the average number of children each woman is having. And over the last 40 years, that rate has been rapidly falling. According to the UN's current data, the world's population is due to peak in 25 years. After it peaks, it will start to go down. By the end of the century, we'll be losing 1 billion people every 20 years. This year, the world's population will hit 7 billion. In 75 years, we'll be back here again. Think about it. When human beings first showed up on this planet, there weren't very many of us. And we faced a hard life of meeting our basic needs. Chances are, early humans spent a good deal of time hungry, cold, and without shelter. That is to say, poor. According to the World Bank, poverty is when people are deprived of well-being as a result of low income and aren't able to get the basic goods that they need for survival with dignity. How did any of the human race advance beyond poverty? We kept multiplying and we formed communities. In communities, people stop spending all their time on simple survival and are able to do things like divide up tasks, share resources, and pool their mental energies to come up with creative solutions to problems. These communities started with families, then grew into extended families, entire tribes, and then finally cities and nations. So what effect has this growth had on poverty? According to demographers, a very good one. In fact, history shows that as our numbers have grown, so has our average standard of living. Scientists measure this standard in everything from per capita income to average amount of calories consumed, even average height. And all of these averages have been increasing. Even though poverty still exists, the percentage of poor people has actually decreased as population has grown. The reason for this is that human beings are not simply consumers, we are producers. This is why, over the ages, we have learned how to do things like produce more food on less land, find better energy sources, and make sure that more people have enough to eat and a roof over their heads. And this is also why, though urban poverty is still a huge problem, statistics show that the poor who move to large communities actually have better chances of rising from poverty than they did in areas where there were fewer jobs and less opportunity. For this reason, poverty is a problem that is not solved by eliminating people. Poverty has always been a problem, even when there were scarcely any people on the entire planet. People are the only proven way out of poverty. Removing them will only leave the poor right where they started. Think about it. From the time of the cavemen all the way until today, humanity continues to exist because each generation of people has produced another generation to replace itself. Scientists have figured out how many people need to be born each generation to replace the generation before. That number is one person per person. All things being equal, this creates perfect demographic balance. Since women are the only ones who can have children, replacing every person on Earth means each woman needs to have two children, one to replace her, and the other to replace the man, who cannot have children. The total fertility rate is the average number of children each woman in a society is having. This number shows us if a society is growing or shrinking. In developed countries, the replacement rate birth rate is 2.1 children per woman. This will keep the population stable, but even that is assuming that every woman has children, and that there are no wars, famines, or disease. In the real world, disasters happen all the time, and sadly, not all children reach adulthood, especially in poor countries. This pushes their replacement rate up to 3.3 children per woman. Since not every woman wants to have children, in order to keep the population stable, some women need to have more than 2.1 children to balance the birth rate with the women who are only having one, or no children at all. Maintaining this balance is of the utmost importance. If society does not at least replace itself every generation, human numbers begin to fall exponentially. Economic and social problems appear, as elderly people retiring begin to outnumber young people entering the workplace. This is already happening all over the developed world. Many of the world's nations are only barely replacing themselves, while a growing majority have birth rates below replacement, some as low as 1.8 or even 1.2 babies per woman. Many societies are facing a very real danger: extinction.
So this is how liberty dies, with thunderous applause.
Do you understand how dark it is? How far down the line we are?